Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد إن أصدق حديث كتاب الله عز وجل وأحسن هدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. All praise is due to Allah Azza wa Jal. We praise Him and we extol Him. And we seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and the evil results of our wrong actions. Whomsoever Allah guides can never be left in misguidance. And whomsoever Allah allows to be left astray, then there is no guide for that individual. Verily, the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, the Quran and Kareem. And the finest guidance is that of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the most evil of affairs are the newly invented ones, bid'ah. And every newly invented matter is a going astray. And every going astray leads to the hellfire. As what follows, my dear brothers in Islam, today I would like to share some advice, as the ulama have stated, coming from Ajwam al-Kalim. Some advice found in one short and concise hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which has been collected in the Sahih of Imam Tirmidhi. And the scholars of Islam have said that because this hadith encompasses all of the deen in its entirety, in such short words, it's of the Ajwam al-Kalim, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was gifted by Allah azza wa jal with the concise speech, which is packed with much benefit. The hadith is on the authority of Abu Dharr al-Ghafari radiallahu anhu and Abu Abdurrahman Mu'adh ibn Jabal. May Allah be pleased with both of them. That the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, اتَّقُ اللَّهِ حَيْثُ مَا قُنْتْ وَاتْبَعَ سَيَّاد حَسَنَةً تَمْحُوهَا وَخَالَقَ النَّاسِ بِكُلِقٍ حَسَنٍ. Be conscious of Allah. Have a consciousness of Allah wherever you may be. And follow up a bad deed with a good deed, and it will wipe it out. It will erase it. And behave with the people with good moral conduct and manners. Firstly, let us mention a little bit about the rawi, the narrators of this hadith. And the first of them is Abu Dharr al-Ghafari, radhiyallahu anhu. Abu Dharr al-Ghafari, he was one about the fourth or fifth person to embrace Islam in Mecca Mukarramah. He heard of the call of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from his tribe, from his village. And him, accompanied by his brother, traveled to Mecca Mukarramah so as to seek out the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, while he was in the Haram in Mecca, Ali ibn Abu Talib noticed this stranger in the vicinity of the Haram in Mecca Mukarramah. So Ali ibn Abu Talib, he approached him and he said to Abu Dharr al-Ghafari, "You seem to be a stranger. How can I help you?" He said, "It is something between me and my Rabb, my Lord, and I'll be fine." He said, "Please tell me, what is it? I would like to help you." He said, "If I tell you, you have to swear that you will not tell anyone else." He said, "Yes, I swear." He said, "I'm looking for a man named Muhammad, this man who is calling to this new religion. I hear that there's a prophet who has emerged in Mecca, and I'm seeking him." He said, "You have come to the right place." He said, "I'm right now on my way to see this man," meaning Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Abu Dharr al-Ghafari and his brother, accompanied by Ali ibn Abu Talib, went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and right away he embraced Islam. But seeing that he was a foreigner, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised Abu Dharr al-Ghafari to keep his conversion to Islam a secret. Abu Dharr al-Ghafari, he says, "La wallah." He said, "I swear by Allah that I will go in front of those people and I will proclaim Islam openly in front of them," which he did. So Abu Dharr al-Ghafari, he went to the Haram in Mecca and he said, "Ya Ayyul Quraysh, oh you assembly of Quraysh, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah." He said, "I bear witness to nothing worthy of worship except Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is his slave and his messenger." And what followed after that, my dear brothers in Islam, they beat Abu Dharr. The people, those mushrikeen of Quraysh, they fell on Abu Dharr al-Ghafari right away, and they beat him, and they beat him nearly to death. If it wasn't for the Amr of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, he covered Abu Dharr because he recognized Abu Dharr al-Ghafari. He covered him and he told the people to stop. They said, "Would you beat a man? Would you kill a man from the tribe of Ghafar and your caravans pass through his territory? Your caravans pass through their territory." So they stopped. And he went back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Dharr al-Ghafari returned back to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Didn't I tell you that this would happen?" But Abu Dharr al-Ghafari, he didn't listen. But he went back again the following day and did the same thing. And again, he got beaten nearly to death. 3 days in a row until Abu Dharr al-Ghaffari, he returned back to his tribe, Ghaffar, and he didn't just go to his tribe and sit there, but he gave da'wah and he called his tribe to Islam, and all of his tribe embraced Islam. And then when the call came, they went and made the hijrah to Medina Munawwara to be with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is just a little glimpse into the life of Abu Dharr al-Ghaffari. And as for the second rawi, narrator of this hadith, is Mu'adh ibn Jabal, brother Anhu, that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said about him that he is the most knowledgeable of this ummah in the matters of halal and haram. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, on the day of judgment, when all of the scholars will be coming forth, Mu'adh ibn Jabal will be steps ahead of them. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in authentic hadith that the most merciful of my ummah to my ummah is Abu Bakr Siddiq, and the most strict of them in deen is Umar ibn Khattab, and the most true of them in modesty is Uthman ibn Affan, and the best judge amongst them is Ali ibn Abu Talib, and the most knowledgeable of them in the matters of halal and haram is Mu'adh ibn Jabal, and the most knowledgeable of them in the laws of inheritance is Zayd ibn Thabit. And he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, truly every ummah has a guardian, and the guardian of this ummah is Abu Bayy ibn Jarrah. May Allah be pleased with all of them. And Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he was also the man who the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam sent as an ambassador of Islam to the people of Yemen. So moving on to this noble hadith, there are three short pearls of advice given in this hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which is the actual visualization of a taqwa. Where the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, "Ittaqillah haythu ma kunt," that we should have a consciousness of Allah wherever we are, in every aspect of our lives. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said that we should have a taqwa. We should be consciousness of Allah. Every likely scenario of our lives, whether we are in public, whether we are alone, whether we are in a situation or a position of leadership, or we're in a situation in a position of weakness, or we are strong, we should always have a taqwa. We should always be aware, at the very least bit, that Allah Azza wa Jal, He is watching us. And this isn't something which is only exclusive for the Ummah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because Allah Azza wa Jal, He had also advised the previous Ummah that they should have a taqwa. Where Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَلَقَدْ وَصَيْنَا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ أَنِ اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ, that Allah Azza wa Jal says in His book that we have recommended to those people who we have given the book before you, meaning us, meaning the Yahud wa Nasara, that they should have a taqwa, and that we should also have a taqwa. So my dear brothers in Islam, our keen awareness and consciousness of Allah Azza wa Jal, at the very least, is taqwa. But in regards to Ashab Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they lived with a higher sense of consciousness and taqwa, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. Their lives were that which was filled with a higher sense or actualization and consciousness of Allah Azza wa Jal, also known as al-maraqabah. That they had a sense that Allah Azza wa Jal, they always perceived that Allah Azza wa Jal is always overseeing their actions. They did not have, as Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum ajma'in, they did not live with a sense of fear, but they lived with a sense of maraqabah, that Allah Azza wa Jal is always proceeding over them, and He is overwatching them, and He's always watching their every movement. So that would give them a sense of peace. That gave them a sense of peace, that they knew and they always felt safe and secure, knowing that their Rabb, Allah Azza wa Jal, was always watching over them. This is an attitude, my dear brothers in Islam, that we all need to strive for, to achieve that sense of maraqabah, that sense that Allah Azza wa Jal is always over us, and that everything that we do, as long as we keep that in mind, in our hearts, that Allah Azza wa Jal is watching over us, that we'll be safe. Thinking about Allah Azza wa Jal in this manner, that Allah Azza wa Jal is proceeding over us in everything that we do. This is the actualization of taqwa. And this should be the goal of every righteous, upright Muslim believer, that we should strive to become more responsible as Muslims. We should strive to be more responsible in our word, in our deed, and in our attentions. We should try and be one of those, as Allah Azza wa Jal called, al-muhsinun. That we always know that Allah Azza wa Jal is proceeding over us. Every step that we take in our lives and everything we engage in, we have to understand with surety that Allah Azza wa Jal will be with us every step of the way. So we can never attain this, my dear brothers in Islam, this sense of a maraqabah, this higher sense of taqwa, except by the permission of Allah Azza wa Jal. We can never achieve this level, this higher state of consciousness and actualization of Allah, except by the permission of Allah Azza wa Jal. This is something that we have to always bear in mind. When we Muslims start acting more responsibly in every aspect, in every sphere of our lives, then inshallah, that will lead us to become al-muhsinun, to actualize the condition and understanding of ihsan, which means excellence in all of our deeds and endeavors of life. And we can find all of this understanding in that hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam, where Jibreel came to ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam about Islam, Iman, and Ihsan. And when he said sallallahu alayhi salam regarding Ihsan, he says that we ta'abud Allah, kanahu tara, fin lam tukun tara, fin hu yara. That we worship Allah Azza wa Jal as if we can see Allah Azza wa Jal. And if we cannot bring ourselves to that level of actualization, then the least thing that we should know is that Allah is always watching us. This isn't something that we should be fearful of. We should be very happy that as Muslims, we understand that we have a Lord. That we have a Lord who is always watching us. He is always watching over us to make sure that we're safe. We should always realize that within ourselves, and we should be very happy. This isn't a thing that we should be afraid of. Allah Azza wa Jalla is al-Wadud. He's a loving Lord. Allah Azza wa Jalla has many Asma al-Husna and Sifa al-Ulya, many names and attributes. But one of his names is Ar-Raqib, that he is overwatching. He is always watching and he's loving. So, the basic difference, my dear brothers, in Islam and Iman between a Muslim and a person who has taqwa, a muttaqi and a muhsin, is that the person of taqwa, he puts within himself and the sin a barrier. He puts a barrier between himself and that ma'asi, that sin. But the person who is al-muhsinun, the person who's living with that higher state, the higher consciousness of Allah, would never ever think of committing any kind of sin or transgressing against themselves or others so as to displease their beloved Allah Azza wa Jal, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear brothers in Islam, this brings us on to the second advice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. While living with that higher consciousness of taqwa, that we should itbal al-sayyat hasna tamhuha. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we should follow up our bad deeds with a good deed and it will erase it and wipe it out. As Allah Azza wa Jal says in his book, innal hasanat yudhibna sayyat. Verily, the good deeds erase and wipe out the bad deeds. This is a hadith. As we found in the Sahih of Imam Bukhari, an authority Ibn Mas'ud said that a man kissed a woman who was not his wife, and he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he prayed, and then Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed to him this ayat: Waqimu salat turfa nahar wa zurfa min al-layl inal hasanat yudhibna sayyiat. That we should perform and establish the prayer at the two ends of the day and at some hours of the night. Verily, the good deeds erase and wipe out the bad deeds. The man asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is this ayat only for me? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, that this ayat is for all of my ummah, kulluhum. So my dear brothers in Islam, the natural response for anyone who commits an error, a mistake, a sin, is that we should not sit back and feel guilty about the mistakes that we made. But we should be in a haste towards tawbah, the maghfirah of Allah. We should be in a hurry, in a haste to do something good so as to erase the bad deed right away. And we shouldn't just sit back and think that it's only a small sin. We shouldn't just sit back with our sin or our mistake, because there isn't any Muslim who would purposely want to do any sin. But trying to live this life, as human beings, we're bound to make mistakes. We're bound to fall into errors. So we shouldn't just sit back and be sad about our mistake, but we should be in a hurry to put something good in its place so as to erase that sin. And there isn't anything better than tawbah. There's an ayah which has been revealed, and there's an authority of Abu Razak who recorded that Anas bin Malik said that, I was told that when the ayat number 35 and 36 of Al Imran was revealed, the shaitan, he screamed and he yelled. And this is the ayat. وَالَّذِينَ فَعَلُوا فَحِيشَةٍ أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكُرُوا اللَّهِ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ ذُنُوبِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَلَمْ يَسِرُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ أُولَئِكَ جَزَاؤُهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَجَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا وَنِعْمَ الْأَجْرُ الْعَامِلِينَ. Allah says in this ayat, Surah Al Imran, and those who, when they have committed fahisha, a sin against themselves, or sexual intercourse, something wrong, who wronged themselves and did evil, they dhakr Allah, they remember Allah, and then they ask Allah for forgiveness for their sins. And none can forgive sins except Allah. And then they do not persist in that sin while they know that they've made a sin. For such who have done so, then for them, they will have prepared for them from Allah gardens, Jannat, gardens underneath which rivers flow. And how excellent is a reward for those who do as such. So my dear brothers in Islam, all we need to do, as the Prophet ﷺ said in his concise hadith, أَتْبَلْ سَيَّاتْ بِالْحَسَنَاتْ تَمْحُوهَا, that we have to follow up a sin, a mistake, with a good deed, and it will be erased. So this is all it is, my dear brothers in Islam, that we have to be a person who's always engaged in hurrying to make tawbah, to erase our evil deeds. And may Allah Azawajal give us all of the tawfiq to be of those who do not hesitate when we know and we recognize that we've made a mistake, but we hurry to make a tawbah. Bismillah, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi huda wa ba'd. So the final advice which was given by the Prophet ﷺ in this noble hadith is that we khaliq an-nas bil khuliq al-hasan, that we interact with each other with good manners. Naturally, when we practice the first two aspects of this hadith, which is attaqallah haythu ma kunt, that we have the consciousness of Allah Azza wa Jal wherever we are, and we follow up a bad deed with a good deed, tamhuha, then naturally, if we do these two things, then we will become a person of good husnul khuluq, good mannerisms. And this, my dear brothers in Islam, is one of the truest signs that a person has iman, that he has real faith, he has tasted the real faith, that a person has well polished adab and mannerism, akhlaq. In truth, in reality, there's many of us who are very good religiously. Many of us pray very well. But when it comes to social interactions, we are the worst people to deal with. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Some of us pray very well. But when it comes to lending and returning small things, we're the worst people to deal with. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There's a hadith which has been collected by Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, and the Muslim of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and the Abu Radha anhu, that the Prophet said, أَكْمَلْ mu'min إِيمَانْهُمْ أَحْسَنَهُ خُلَقَ أَوْ كَمَ قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ, the most complete of the believers in their faith is the person who has the best manners. Also, in the collection of Ibn Majah and the Muslim of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, on the authority of Uthman bin Sharr, who said that the Sahabas asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is the best character trait given to a Muslim? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, husnul khulq, good manners. And Imam Ahmad, he said that good manners, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam the Sunnah, he said that good manners, it means that we do not, and we should never become angry and nervous. We should never become angry and to the point that we become nervous. So my dear brothers in Islam and Iman, Allah Azza wa Jal, He has praised the person who has good, noble conduct and manners in many places in His book. And Allah Azza wa Jal has also praised the person who wards off evil by doing good in many places in His book. And Allah Azza wa Jal, He has reminded us that if we are in the habit of doing that, warding off evil and bad by doing good, then Allah Azza wa Jal will raise us to high, high stations. Let us close off our khutbah today with what Allah Azza wa Jal has said regarding all of this in Surah Fussilat, ayah number 34 and 35. Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسْنَةُ وَلَا سَيِّئَاتُ ادفع بالتي هي احسن فاذا الذين بينك وبينه العداوه كانه ولي حميد وما يلقاها الا الذين صبروا وما يلقاها الا ذو الحظ العظيم. Allah Azza wa Jal says, or not equal are the good deeds and the bad deeds. Repel, ward off the evil by that which is better. And then the one who you have a hostility with, or you're in bad terms with, they will become your very, very wali al-hamid, close friend. And none is granted this type of understanding except for the one who has a sabr. And none is granted this type of attitude and characteristic except for the one who's been given a great amount, dhul hadd al-azim. Ibn Abbas, who commenting on this verse, said that Allah Azza wa Jal, He has commanded the believers in this verse and in many places that we should be patient, forbearing. Whenever we feel angry, we should be forbearing and patient whenever we are confronted with ignorance. And we should always turn to forgiveness when we're confronted with ignorance and whenever we are mistreated by others. And if we do this, then Allah Azza wa Jal, He will subdue the shaitan, our enemy, and He will make us all as close bosom brethren. So let us, my dear brothers in Islam, practice these words of advice found in this noble hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he says, اتَّقُ اللَّهَ حَيْثُ مَا قُنْتُ. We should be conscious of Allah wherever we may be, whether we're in the work, whether we are with our friends, whether we're in the masjid, whether we're alone, in privacy, anywhere we are. And we should follow up a bad deed with a good deed, tamhuha, and it will be erased. And we should khaliq al-nas wa khaliq al-hasan. And we should interact with the people with the best of moral manners and conducts. May Allah Azza wa Jal bless all of us and grant us the understanding and grant us the tawfiq from Allah Azza wa Jal, that He would allow us and bless us and make us of those who practices those noble characteristics found as hadith. Amin, amin, amin. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, sallu alayhi wa sallimu tasliman. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barak ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, innaka hamidun majid. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina adhaban nar. Wa aqim as-salat.